we journey for a minute inside space.
Spend a moment with us inside space. Inside Space, Friday nights at 10:30 and 2:30 Eastern, and Sunday mornings at 11.
I could not believe it. It was really fun.
That psychic was amazing.
The Psychic Solution challenged us to test their psychics and see just how real they are. So we asked people on the street to try a three-sample psychic reading.
Then she described what I wanted and said it was...
Hello, I'm Christopher Lee, and you're watching the Sci-Fi Channel.
Welcome to the show. I'm Shashi in L.A. Today, it's a rock and roll extravaganza. We have backstage passes and we're not afraid to use them.
Hi, I'm Nick in New York City. You know, rock and roll and comics go back a long way. From the Beatles to the alternative bands of the 90s. Bill?
Oh, yeah. This is Phil here in Toronto, and you've tuned into the Anti-Gravity Room.
What's your favorite Saturday morning cartoon theme song?
Favorite Saturday morning cartoon would definitely have to be Spider-Man. I had my Spider-Man shirt on, Spider-Man underwear, and my Spider-Man action figure. Spider-Man does whatever a spider can.
They call me Yuck Mouth. That's because I brush my teeth, and that was it.
That's my favorite one, Yuck Mouth.
My favorite Saturday morning theme is Penelope Can't Stop.
No, Josie and the Pussycats.
They rock.
My favorite Saturday morning theme song is Hong Kong Phooey. But I can't sing it.
Josie and the Pussycats. That's all I can do.
Yep, no matter how old you are, everyone watches Saturday morning cartoons. A lot of them have cool theme songs. Now check it, this guy Ralph Stowe, he took all these alternative bands to re-record these theme songs. And with their powers combined, they created Saturday Morning.
Well, Saturday Morning is an album of all your favorite cartoon songs, like Scooby-Doo, Josie and the Pussycats, Underdog, the Banana Splits, done by like a plethora of alternative stars. It's a total buzz bin fiesta.
Why do you think people love cartoon themes so much?
Well, I think that people remember the themes from their association with the cartoons themselves, you know. Saturday morning was the morning where it wasn't so hard to get up early because the cartoons were on. So you'd go and you'd watch the shows and you'd get in your head these songs that some songwriter sat in a room to write the catchiest thing they could think of in a minute or less, and it just stuck into kids' brains.
Theme songs considered good musically, or are they simply just memorable jingles?
Well, my goal in picking the cartoon songs, let's say if I picked the Banana Splits, the idea was to make it an ultimate Liz Phair song, Liz Phair who performed the song on the record, so that we arranged it together and produced it so that you'd hear it and go, wow, what a great Liz Phair song. Wait, that's a cartoon song?
Between real rock and comic rock?
Well, part of the reason I made the record was that I believe it's all a big blur. I mean, you know, the Beatles are the ultimate in real credible rock. and the Partridge Family was made for TV. And the Archies were all animated. They weren't even a real band. But they all had number one singles, and they all were on Saturday morning TV. So, I mean, to a kid especially, it was all a big blur.
Comics book that comes with this album?
Marvel Comics, in fact, put out a Saturday morning comic book, which has about a dozen different artists, like Mike Allred, who does Madman, and people doing a comic book version of the album in which me and all the bands save the world from a group of interlopers called the Suits, who have made everyone into zombies through bad music, and it takes cartoon rock to make people human again.
Except for the Ren and Stimpy song, most of the music on this album is considered vintage. What new cartoon theme song do you like?
Well, I have to say that most new cartoons have forsaken the art of cartoon theme songs. For instance, the new Spider-Man show, it rocks. But where's the Spider-Man song? It's not on there. Buy the record. The Ramones rock.
One day, as I was wandering around the city, I came across a very strange home that happens to be inhabited by two very cool people who are in this band called The Cramps. And Ivy of the Cramps, and we're going to find out the connection between rock and roll and comics. Do you read any of the new comics or just the older stuff? And why?
Mainly just the older comics. I like the artwork on the older comics a lot more. And there was also something sicker about it back then because those artists were taking their lives in their hands. They could go to jail for what they were doing then. Nowadays, anything goes, so it's not as dangerous.
Are comic books a bad influence on young minds?
Ooh, they can be. I mean, they teach you how to be a professional juvenile delinquent.
Other than the Cramps, what other bands represent a comic book style?
I think the 5678s from Japan represent a comic book style. They have a lot of James Bond, kind of Batman, kind of crazy influences.
What about Josie and the Pussycats? What about the Archies? The Bugaloos? What comic most represents the rock and roll spirit?
I'd say the complete line of EC horror comics in the 50s. They were the ones that really changed the culture around and got the parents frightened, just like rock and roll did in the 50s.
No food, no water. What comics would you like on a desert island?
If I was on a desert island, which three comic books I'd bring with me? Well, I don't know the titles, but back in the 70s, DC Comics published a lot of 100-page giants, and I bring three of those because I figure on a desert island, I'm going to need a lot of paper.
Okay, sit back, relax, and enjoy the song stylings of Pat Boone. I'm just kidding. At least I hope I am.
Retro science. Retro fiction.
Amazing.
Retro TV. Tonight at 3 a.m.
There are a lot of rock and roll legends who have found new life in comic books. One of them is Alice Cooper.
Neil Gaiman about one of the most popular rock comics in recent years, The Last Temptation.
Do you think there's a connection between rock and roll and comics?
I think there is a connection between rock and roll and comics, partly because rock and roll people like comics, and because comics people tend to like rock and roll. What there haven't been is many good rock and roll comics. When I tried my only experiment in rock and roll comics, the Alice Cooper comic, someone from Marvel phoned me up and said, you know, can I think of a good advertising tagline? And I said, yeah, Neil Gaiman and Michael Zulli present Alice Cooper's The Last Temptation. Who says rock and roll comics have to be crap?
I'm focusing in on rock and roll and comics. So first up, we have the Rock and Roll High School. This is a kind of based on the movie from the 80s, except it's been readapted for the 90s. It's got the Melvins instead of the Ramones. And I was talking to Sandman over here earlier, and he gives it 2 G's on the anti-gravity scale. That's out of 4. That's pretty good. Next, we have 2 books that are very much the same and very much different. First off, it's the Alice Cooper and the Rolling Stones comic. The only difference between the two is one is good and one sucks. Okay, this one actually has a story, it has good art, fabulous writing by Neil Gaiman. I'd say definitely pick this up. It's The Crow. Yes, my secretive sources have informed me that there will not only be a second Crow movie, but there will be a second Crow comic book series. Yes, this comic book series will be drawn by Alex Maleev of Magic the Gathering fame. And now, from Rock and Roll Comics, we go to Rock and Roll CDs and Video Games with Phil, checking out stuff in the techno world.
Okay, this week we will be reviewing Sega Saturn's Cyber Speedway. Now, with all the game systems, you have this. You have your driving games, and you have your sort of future driving games, and this is Sega Saturn's. Now, when I first tried out the game, I used this regular Sega Saturn controller, and it was an alright game. You know, it's a beautiful looking game. You get to choose where you're gonna race, you get to choose your sled, you get to choose story mode or regular mode, which is when story mode's chosen, you get to kind of hear the history of your driver and what you're trying to achieve. Now, I played the game again with Sega's latest peripheral, the Sega Saturn steering wheel. This thing is a gem. You can tilt it. Oh yeah. You can raise the wheel. It's just like a car. Choose the way you want to go. And when you start playing the game again with the steering wheel, totally different game. Much more control. You don't have this going on, which is a natural thing when you're playing the driving games. So you get into the wheel here, and I gotta tell you, when Sega Saturn comes out with more games that can use this wheel, definitely pick this wheel up if you like driving games, because it makes all the difference in the world. Now, to the game, great playing game. It's a beautiful looking game. The graphics are beautifully rendered. Music by the Bygone Dogs. They got original music happening. It's a happening game if you have the steering wheel. On the anti-gravity scale, I have to give this like a 4, just because of the look and the gameplay. Once you get this,
so how did you guys start your own comic company?
I've always been into comics, and I wasn't happy with all the stuff that, you know, was coming out, and just decided to do it a little differently, and wanted to put out all my favorite stuff. Simon, we worked together on an album cover.
What attracted you guys to the work of Frank Frazetta?
Something I was drawn to. I mean, I was a kid about 8 years old, and I saw a Conan cover in a bookshop, and I was just drawn to it. It just hit me in the face, and I just could not believe it. It was stunning. There's something inside, and it's difficult to explain it, really, so I'm not going to.
When I was a kid, I saw his paintings, and so it was partly responsible for me starting to read books, getting into reading.
You've got this kind of weird drawing style that's a mix between painting and, you know, comic art. Where'd you pick that up?
Just from a lot of inspirations. You know, you got fine arts, you got just visual things just around a place to look at, and comics is an amalgamation of a lot of things and a lot of experiences, and it just comes out, and I don't understand it. I can't explain it.
I'm just at all, right?
No, I'm just good, you know? My natural. And it shows.
U2, Sonic Youth, Green Day, and Pearl Jam are all bands that turned us down for interviews. But hey, we did get Poison.
Some companies offer the world when it comes to saving on international calls, but those...
Now walk into any record store like this HMV Superstore here in Toronto, and you'll see a lot of bands with comic book related covers and or songs. With me to talk about this subject is
the one and only Ty Templeton.
Hey, Phil, how are you? How you doing?
Not bad. Good, good. Well, what have you done? What are you doing now?
At the moment, I'm working for Mad Magazine. I write and draw Batman Adventures, and I occasionally do the covers for X-Men videos, which are on sale over there.
But Ty, what do you think is the relationship between rock and roll and comic books?
Well, basically, rock and roll and comic books are both aimed at young people. I mean, there's not much of a relationship between rock and roll and prune juice, you know? It's got to be stuff that kids and young people are especially going to enjoy. There's a lot of energy in both of them.
Now, what's your relationship with rock and roll, say, and comic books?
I used to be a rock musician before I became a comic book artist, but sadly enough, comics pay better than rock. Isn't that sad? I was a rock musician for about 4 years, made my living at it, and one time I put together a comic book that had a record inside it that I wrote and recorded and performed and sang and did all the stuff except play the drums.
I heard about this. It's
Critters number 23.
23. Yeah. I thought it was 27.
Yeah, a lot of people think it's 27, but it's Critters number 23, and the cover is it's like a teddy bear lighting a cigarette.
Okay, now how does music, say, affect your comic book artwork? Like, do you listen to certain tunes?
All the time. I like to listen to Elvis Costello. He's probably my favorite musician. When I'm writing a Batman story, I actually do put on the Batman soundtrack albums, like the Prince album or the Danny Elfman did the other one.
Right.
I will actually put them on because they'll get me into the mood of writing the story because the music is so gothic and dark and all that kind of stuff. And it gets you a sense of Gotham City and all that.
All right, Ty Templeton with us at the HMV Superstore.
Nice seeing you.
Thanks, man. Now, for the band perspective, Cub is a hot new alternative band that's had a long, long relationship with comic books.
I drown in your pool.
We got to talk to them in between sound checks, and here's what they had to say.
Hey, what do you guys think is the relationship between rock and roll and comic books?
Everybody in rock can be taken as a different cartoon character. I'm definitely Nancy.
And also, anybody can do either one.
What is your relationship with comics?
I read them. I like them. Julie Doucette, my favorite comic artist in the entire world.
Now, Linda Barry.
Rules. And she is of what fame?
She is of Ernie Poop's comic, and also she has done a number of books as well, like The Good Times Are Killing Me, you know, stuff like that. It's just amazing.
My favorite is just good old Archie comics, Betty and Veronica. You can't go wrong with them.
Can't go wrong with Betty and Veronica?
No, good clothes.
And tell me about this album cover here.
That was done by Fiona Smith, who lives right here in Toronto. And she's a friend of ours, and when we asked her, we actually didn't know she was a fabulous comic artist when we met her. We just met her as a friend, and we're hanging around, and I think it wasn't until about a week later that she said, oh, I do comics, and I do this one called Nocturnal Emissions. And we were like, wow, that was one of our favorites, and of course we'd seen it and read it and loved it. So we asked her to do the cover for Come Out, Come Out, and she said, sure.
I'm sure you've heard of the bands Green Jelly and Poison. Well, Shashi got a chance to talk to these guys quite recently in L.A.
Hey, is this the place where Green Jello lives?
I think you came to the right place.
Now, Joe, the band is called Green Jelly, and it's even spelled Green Jelly, but yet the pronunciation is Green Jello.
True. That's because we got sued by that giant corporation, and they said you better change your name from Jello to Jelly, otherwise we're going to take everything you own. But we don't have anything! So where does that get you?
So tell us about the pig song. Were you surprised by its popularity?
Surprised? Nah.
Have any of your songs been used in movies or video games?
Many of our songs have been used in video games and movies. We were in Dumb and Dumber, and we were in the Maximum Carnage video game, and we were on the Fantastic Four Saturday morning cartoon show. And what else do we do?
Flintstones movie.
Born to Be Wild.
Ben, when you write your music, I heard that you don't come up with musical or lyrical ideas. You come up with characters, and then you write your songs based around these characters. Is that true?
Yes. I am Dunderhead.
I am the Cow God.
I'm Pinata Head.
It all starts with a costume.
Well, I hear you're coming out with a comic book.
We are coming out with a comic book, and as a matter of fact, I have a copy of it right here.
Good Lord.
And it's coming out on DC Comics, and it will be out early next year.
Is the style of this comic influenced by any other comic?
It's influenced by all comics. We steal from everywhere all the time.
Little big left me in.
Surveys, yes, it's another wacky anti-gravitational poll. This week, we want to know what grosses you out. You can call or you can email us at antigravity@ytv.ca or write to us at the Anti-Gravity Room, care of YTV Canada, 64 Jefferson Avenue, Unit 18, Toronto, Canada, M6K3H3.
Hi, we're here with Ricky Rocket and Mark Williams. Ricky is the drummer for the band Poison, and Mark is his collaborator on his upcoming comic book, Sisters of Mercy.
Basically, Ricky and I have known each other for about 10 years now, and we're both interested in the same things, like comic books and horror films and things like that, and we figured, heck, let's do a comic book together.
Sisters of Mercy actually was an idea that I thought would be great for a movie, and Mark has been in the movie business for a long time doing special effects, and we started to storyboard this idea, and we ended up saying, why don't we just do this into a comic book?
We wanted to do it independently, but then we took it around to different people, and everybody seemed to like it. Ricky had a dream, actually, about these women, like, in this wasteland, commanding wolves and things like that. So, and it kind of grew out of that.
I heard that this was based on your girlfriend, and this is your girlfriend's sister.
Yeah, she forced me into it.
I've actually met Ricky's girlfriend, and she's a librarian for the Van Nuys School District.
Basically, Mark does the pencil and ink, and the reason it was just luck of the draw, I guess, that I got a friend that's talented to that degree, that can draw things and ink things, and so it was next. It was kind of like up to me to come up with the color. We said, "What are we going to do about color?" And I had messed around with the computer for years and Photoshop and other painting programs, and so I decided to give it a shot. Comic book art is just unrecognized in America. I mean, it's just, everyone thinks it's for kids, and these guys are talented. I mean, there is some real, real talent out there.
After this, the secret words to Silverchair's song, Fat Boy, decoded with this issue of Fantastic Four. I'm just kidding.
We've consulted our think tank and discovered the ultimate sci-fi weekend. 2 days of...
Next time we find out what grosses you out more than anything in the world. Roaches, slime, dirty diapers, bitter defeat. Find out next time.
Rock and comics, two art forms that inspire one another. Let's hope the connection never dies.
So until Galactus picks up a guitar and starts jamming with Weezer, make mine the Anti-Gravity Room. See you next time.